Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:05 p.m. Central Time on the 25th of October, 2017, and we are here on the Earthquake 3D live streams Wednesday going into Thursday, so we're halfway through the week, and we issued a earthquake forecast starting on Sunday night. In case you're new here and you don't know, we issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. And over the past 2 days, well, day and a half, we started issuing warnings in the West Pacific due to a new deep earthquake that measured in at 6.7. So this is a sizable earthquake striking over in the West Pacific. And today, let's get into the activity that struck throughout the day. First of all, new deep earthquakes struck starting last night after my update, internationally speaking, going forward into today. So we had new deep earthquake activity measuring in over here at Fiji. Additionally, pressure spread out from our deep earthquake location. And let me bring it back on the feed here so you can see it. You obviously see it raised high off the globe so you can identify how deep the earthquake is. And going out in each direction from this earthquake, we have shallower earthquakes, but not larger earthquakes. And I suppose this is good news. We're coming in exactly one magnitude less than where we were looking to see, and or a magnitude and a half less in the location to the west. And here we would expect maybe a 6.5 to 7.5 earthquake. And so far, we're a magnitude and a half lower. Going up to Japan, it's pretty obvious. Pressure spread up to Japan, and an equal-sized earthquake within one magnitude struck over in Taiwan. Now, we know to expect this. This earthquake here next to Guam on the South Izu Ridge indicates that pressure is coming up in both directions, as we would expect when there's a deep earthquake pushing down far south. Also, we would expect pressure to go over to the west. And that's exactly what's happening right now. So you see these swarms of earthquakes over in Indonesia, and you see a few fives going up towards Japan. That's just a sign that pressure's transferring out day one here on our 10-day earthquake watch for this big earthquake to have an effect. Could take up to 10 days. We've seen it take that long. There's past examples. So the other deep earthquake that struck is this 5.0 on the South Izu Ridge. Now, a deep 5 on its own can cause a shallow 6, or possibly all the way up to a shallow 7. But I'm not thinking that this earthquake on its own would be causing that. But let's look at the last couple days. Take a look at it. All the earthquakes raised high off the globe indicate where there's deep earthquake activity, going down to New Zealand, up to Fiji, all the way over to Indonesia, and up towards Japan at this point. This is all in the past few days. So it's not an exaggeration to say that this is a deep earthquake event picking up, not just a deep earthquake that we saw over on the west side of the Pacific. So there's multiples here, okay? And this means bigger activity. I'm not just, you know, showing them to you to talk about them. The reason the deep earthquakes matter is because they cause shallower, larger earthquakes in between where the deep earthquakes are. And they're the middle point in between each set of deep quakes that should be hit. Additionally, look which way the arrows point from where these deep earthquakes are. So we have two deep earthquakes here. That means New Zealand, you're going to be getting hit again. And I'm going to have to say it'll probably be a mid-range to upper 4, maybe even a low 5 again. So last time I undershot it by a magnitude. If we're going to name out a location, we have to look from just north of Wellington to just south at Kiakura as our potential swarm spot. So if we're going to look in the next few days, that's the spot we're going to look for 4.0 plus activity to strike. Now that's based upon the deep earthquakes to your north. These deep earthquakes will also push to the west and to the east across our two arrows going into South America, and I'll explain that in a few minutes, but over here to the west, we have a central point right here that should also get hit by seismic activity, at least one magnitude larger, more like two. Now, why am I saying two magnitudes larger than the deep fours? Well, look at this guy right here. Now, this is a backflow. If any of this pressure on this earthquake comes over to the east, it's going against the overall flow of the seismic pressure that's been observed. So the chances of it throwing all of its pressure over to the east are lower than it going over to the west and striking in our silent zone. Now, this gets a little bit complex. You can see how this earthquake here is right in the middle in between our two sets of quakes that happened today. So first the deep earthquake happened, then spreading out in two directions, up towards Japan and over to the west. Well, you'll see a new earthquake striking at the India-Myanmar border where this island is here. Well, guys, there's a big silent zone right here. See it? Pretty obvious. Okay, I do that, so I get your attention. Look at the screen. This is the silent zone at the center of the screen. We go down to the middle of the silent zone, and that's the spot that we watch. So if we're going to look for activity, that would be the next spot we watch over to the west. Additionally, we have to look up here in between our next set of quakes. That puts Philippines. So we have an earthquake at Taiwan. We have an earthquake down here in Indonesia. We also have an earthquake on Guam, basically, and going down to the letter D again. Halfway point between each of these should be hit, and then to the north. Look at our halfway point to the north, between the 4.1 and the 4.6. What's right in the middle? Well, Sakurajima Volcano, Suwanojima Volcano, and Kirishimayama Volcano. All three erupted last week. Now all three are not erupting, and we'll consult the volcanic eruption feed in a second. Now magnitudes on this, guys. Magnitudes matter. Huge, okay? I mean, this is a huge, huge deal. We're talking about possibly going up to 8.7. 7.7 to 8.7 is what could be caused off this deep earthquake. Now, I hope I got it wrong, and I hope we get to the end of the 10-day cycle and that only a smaller, maybe a 7 hits. But that's still big. That's still big. It would be larger than the 6.7. So we look between 6.7 and 8.7. Now the chance of it going all the way up to 8.7 is fairly slim. It's more likely to go up a full magnitude, which is a tenfold increase in power, and strike in the nearby silent zones, and we're going to say zones plural because it's moving out in multiple directions, just as expected. Again, you got to understand, this big earthquake is actually putting pressure up on the underside of the plate. Now see this dome? See where the edges go out on the dome too? See? All the way over into Papua New Guinea, down around Australia, and then back over here to Sumatra, Indonesia. Now look at the earthquakes today, and you'll see, look what struck inside the dome. So inside the dome, the first round to come up, day one of the 10-day watch, we see this. And going right out to the perimeter, we get our other 5.0. Just as expected, we expect this. We watch for this to happen, and I talked about it just the other night when this deep earthquake occurred. And here we are now, okay? And let's go over and look at the other earthquakes that struck. Down in New Zealand right now, you're all in the 3 range. And that's, I guess, good news, but I think you're going back up. There's pretty much no doubt about it with these deep earthquakes happening the way they are. Also, over here to the west, like I said, a 4.7 struck right next to India-Myanmar border. This island here belongs to India, and Myanmar is right here where the red arrow is. So we have pressure coming out of the West Pacific. Also, north of India, north of Pakistan at the Afghanistan border, new 4.5. That's pretty small for that location, and that's good. But again, I'll get into this in a second. By the end of the broadcast, we'll have a watch out for this location to the east. So see where the 4.7 is, see where the 4.5 is. Well, guys, we're going to look right in the middle right here for a new earthquake to strike that should be bigger than either of these by a full magnitude. But first things first, we got to wait for this to spread out. I mean, it is, but it's going out, what is that, 500 to 800 miles in each direction? And then up to Japan, that's like about 2,500 miles. So I would think that pretty soon here, we're going to be looking at a new earthquake striking in between these two sets, and it's going to be larger than either set. Now let's get into Europe. Let's talk about this. First of all, yesterday's swarm carried on to today at the Italy southeast France border at Torino, where the plate boundary dead ends into Torino. But look at this, guys. Look at this. 4.7, 4.2, 4.1, 2.5, and another 4.2, all striking right at Albania-Bosnia's border. So this is Albania right here, this little country. This is Bosnia. And we issued a warning for Albania next to Greece. So we issued our warning for here, and it struck right here. That's within the realm of acceptability for any earthquake forecaster. And to get it down to 4.7, if you add these together, guess what it equals? You take the 4.7 plus the 4.2. Now, a couple of these are doubled reports because we have the European feed turned on, two of them. But anyways, 4.7 plus 4.2, okay, that equals 4.82. Add in the 4.1, we're getting to 4.93. Add in the other 4.2, we're at 5.05. In other words, a 5.0. So we issued the warning, and look how close it is to central Italy, where Norcia is, right here. So right, just right across. And we're looking for pressure to go also over into Romania, across here, across central Italy, and central Italy has increased. Let's go quickly turn on the INGV, last 150 earthquakes, and let me get a sip of my hot cocoa. Ooh, okay, great. Now, let's look at the earthquakes. Obviously, we see a stretch of earthquakes, but each earthquake center was at 0 to 1 yesterday. Today, it's going up into 2s, to 2.9 to be exact, and a 2.9 near 3.0 striking here on the southern coast of Italy. And we gotta go look this one up, because this one's more rare. It's a 3.0 on the southern coast of Italy. Nobody's even talking about it. And I'm surprised. So let's just go pull the coordinates. I mean, look, it's not very often you get a 3.0 near Rome, right? All right, let's go. I mean, I don't know how close it is to Rome. I guess we need to take a look. Now, there's an increase happening, not only in Bosnia-Albania border, but in Italy, because pressure's coming in from a series of 4.0 earthquakes. Okay, where are we? There's Colle Albani, and there's Rome. So from downtown Rome to the earthquake itself, and this is from the center of Rome, 60 kilometers? Oh, that's not far at all. That's 40 miles. Okay, so we have a supervolcano here, Colle Albani, and when you look at it, you know what? We should look at it just because it's so impressive. Check this out. Now, you see the caldera here, the large caldera. It's very, very round, of course. It stands out. Now, inside of it, inside of the greater caldera, we have a smaller rising, almost a stratovolcano that's blown out in the past. Almost the size, let's say, of a small Mount St. Helens. Then you have two other blast craters here that are filled with water, and one here that's been drained or drained over time. That's a previous crater. Now get this, down here inside of here, there's another set of volcanoes right there. A cinder that's popped up in the past. It's covered in grass now, but you can make it out. It has a sill at the center. And that's there. And then down here, we have another one that a long, long time ago, and you can still make out the crater at the center of that. You know, whoever lives there probably knows. They probably have a little bit of geothermal activity there still. Anyways. Look at it. It's huge. And then over to the east, we have our earthquake. That's a 3.0. Oh, and we see activity increasing in Italy. You get 5.0 total equivalent, or 4.7, 4.2, 4.1, 4.2, and a bunch of twos striking in Bosnia, all on the same day that you see an activity increase up at Torino going into southeast France. That went up to 3.7. That is a huge increase from where you were. Now, why is there an increase coming in all of a sudden? Well, guys, there were a series of fours that happened over the past few days down to your east southeast. 4.5, 4.6, 4.1, 4.2. Add those together, it equals about the same, and then you had a new push coming in from over here. So we talked about that over the past few days. Go watch my updates over the past few nights. if you're very curious, or go watch the forecast that called for all this to happen. Now let's turn off the Italy feed, the INGV feed, and quickly consult a few others, because this is important. We need to consult over in the USGS feed for the United States. Sorry, guys, I hate to even refer to it as a separate feed, but it is. So the Italian feed shows us the earthquakes out of Italy and some of the international large earthquakes, but doesn't do a very good job of showing us anything else internationally speaking. When we look at the United States, starting last night or yesterday, we saw an increase in the Midwest. You remember that? Across Texas. Well, today, a new 3.1 struck back at our famous fracking operations. And we're going to pull our coordinates. I'll show you guys. Now, here's what's going on. The reason 3 and 4.0 earthquakes and the equivalent there too are striking in the Midwest at Oklahoma, Kansas, Texas is because humans have drilled down into the crust. Some portions, several thousand feet, drilled down into the crust where they then inject what's called wastewater, and that's just a slang term for the chemical-laden water designed to break down the shale. The shale breaks down, releases natural gas and oil. And then what's left is a hydraulically charged chamber that goes several thousand feet down into the ground, usually charged with water or some kind of fluid and gases. Now, humans have done thousands of drill points throughout here, and for every well I have marked, here, let me show you. So you can see some of them are very small, right? And then others are, we've got a pipeline going through here, going to another frack well here, and you got oil being done at that location. Another one across here. I'm just randomly zooming in just to show you. I mean, these go on and on and on. For every one that I marked, there's several more out here that are not marked that should be. And I just don't have the time to go through. I mean, every time I do mark them, they come over and do a new flyover at some point, and there's 100 more that are being developed. So that's just every little white square pad shows us a different drill point. And it goes on for county after county after county. And so it's a weak point, a perforation in the crust. And it got pushed from the west coast to the east. So first a push happened on the west coast, a 4.8 out here off the coast. That then resulted in a 4.1 off the coast of LA, and then a new swarm in the Midwest. Again, ending out with a 3.1. But looking at California, we actually need to talk about this too. So not only are we looking for a large earthquake over in the West Pacific, actually a series of larger earthquakes over the next several days. This is go time in the West Pacific, but this is going to increase things. This deep earthquake and these deep earthquakes here are going to increase things for Europe, and they're going to increase things for the United States, Central America, and South America. Every plate that's attached to the Pacific plate is going to see an increase over the next few days. No doubt about it, we are in a deep earthquake event. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 6 or 7 different deep earthquakes in the past few days, if you incorporate in the events over in Italy and in South America. And that, to me, says the Pacific plate is on the move. When the Pacific plate moves, guess who moves with it? Guess who moves? Look at the screen. You move on the West Coast. Not just anywhere on the West Coast, though. See where the fracture zone is here? The famous Juan de Fuca lightning bolt-shaped fracture zone? That zone becomes locked and loaded. Then it pushes onto land here, causing swarms of what are called tremors, small little vibrations as the plate starts to move side by side. That being said, let's go quickly consult the real-time tremor map. Let me get a different display capture here turned on. 1 second. If we can get this. Well. Okay. There we go. So looking at the screen now, you're going to see a graphic showing the North American craton. And I put the black arrows on here indicating which way pressure flows from west to east. Now make note of the middle black arrow coming in over Northern California. And look in between Northern California and Washington where the northern black arrow is coming in. Now, guys, that is the Juan de Fuca fracture zone, the Z-shaped, S-shaped fracture zone. When it starts to build in pressure, that's when I worry. That's when I start to talk about it every night, start to make it a point of my broadcast, to show it to you, talk about it, and then tell you that when we get movement on land, and we can detect this by going to the real-time tremor map, take a look at the screen, please, and you will see that there's only two little red dots on here over the past few hours. Now, let's click on 24 hours, and you'll see there's a few down in California and just a few up in Seattle. Now, I'm going to click on 48 hours, and you'll be able to see there's a big cluster up in Seattle and a pretty nice cluster down in Oregon. In the last 24 hours, it started to go quiet. Now, here's what we're going to look for. When this zone starts to go quiet, we'll give it a few days. We'll give it about 3, maybe 4 days where we're going to watch this and look for smaller or larger events to increase. So either a whole bunch of little small tremors or a few larger earthquakes striking along the interior portion of the coast should happen in the next few days. And if it doesn't, if we don't see anything strike on land in the next few days of just smaller size, then I'm going to issue a warning for the potential of a large earthquake to strike out here off the coast. You got to understand what's going on. There's a slow slip happening between the plates that's pretty normal. It actually goes on, it carries on for many months sometimes, sometimes it goes on for a few weeks, sometimes it goes on for many months, and in this case, it's been going on for about 9 months or 10 months, starting here at the Olympic Peninsula, then going up into Vancouver, then going down into Northern California, and then going kind of bouncing back and forth up and down here on land. Now, every time it starts to go quiet, so we just saw, like I said, a big cluster up here around Seattle. When it starts to go quiet, that's when we see new movement strike off the coast. Now, this is interesting because look at what the USGS is reporting to us earthquake-wise up here. Let me turn on our 0.0 and greater feed, just so there's no confusion. See this? Okay, so USGS showing us everything supposedly 0.0 and greater that would be of interest to us, not just in the continental United States, but they show us some twos and threes internationally around the world. So the USGS is fully, and right up here in Alaska, look at that. So you would think that you might get some earthquake reports if there was anything really going on out here. I mean, the USGS would not keep the public in the dark, would they? Would they? Well, let's go turn on the Natural Resources of Canada feed and see what our good old neighbors up north are reporting. Grab your Molsons, get your Molsons, and hold on to your moose hats. Because when I show this to you, and sorry, I don't mean to stereotype you guys. What do you wear? Boonskin caps? What do you got? Raccoon skins? I don't know. It's Canada. Probably all of the above. Anyways, take a look at what's going on. Port Hardy, Canada, all of a sudden had a swarm breakout. Swarm broke out at Port Hardy, Canada. And what can I say? A swarm is broken out because incoming pressure from up in Alaska. Now, where did incoming pressure from up in Alaska happen? Let's turn off the Natural Resources of Canada feed now. I just wanted to show it to you. So there's a swarm of threes that's broken out there, going up to, I think, 3.9. They may have downgraded it, upgraded it. Turning on the USGS last 7-day feed. Just take a look at this. So here we are, it's pretty obvious, the 5.0 that struck up here, pushed over into Alaska, and down here where there's a swarm of threes. And that swarm of threes, guys, if you add it all up together, it actually adds up to a single four. So take it for what you will, it's a four striking off the coast, which means, guess what? Even though the USGS isn't reporting it, guess who's going to feel the impact on that? Guess who isn't getting hit today, by the way? Idaho. Idaho and Yellowstone. You are going to flare back up due to this new 4.0 activity, or a whole bunch of threes striking off the coast of western coast of Canada. So it doesn't matter if the USGS misses it or ignores it, because we will see the subsequent activity downstream. So if you're in California, let's quickly jump into this. Let's turn back on our 0.0 and greater feed and just quickly warn you for what's getting ready to happen here. You're going to get hit by new activity off the coast to the northwest in just a little bit here. Now, there are warning signs that show up before something happens here off the coast to the northwest. The warning signs are 3 to 4-fold, and all 3 to 4, and I'm going to say 4, really have to be met before you see a larger earthquake off the coast. 1, west coast, your dormant and active volcanoes both begin to swarm simultaneously with multiple stacks of earthquakes. Now, you're welcome to go check me out on this. You don't have to take my word for it. Go look up several of these earthquakes, this 1.9 or this 0.4 or the 0.7. Go look those up, at least these three, and you'll find out each one. One is at Rainier, right below the peak. Again, Mount Rainier, the volcano. The others are surrounding Mount St. Helens on both sides. Going down to the south, we have ancient volcanoes out here, and technically in central Oregon. Let's get that up on the map here so you can see what's there. I'll turn on my place mark so it makes it just a little bit easier from the Smithsonian. And, I mean, when we get down in here, there's a huge volcanic field that's connected to Three Sisters, and then these are numbered. Again, there's so many of them. So I guess I'll have to turn this at an angle so you can see them kind of going off up towards Mount Bachelor. But coming off of Mount Bachelor, we have several cinders. So there's one, and then it carries on into a chain where it starts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. They don't even have names to them. Maybe they do somewhere, but and it just goes on in a row. And then you have another row here. See these? They're all cinders as well, just covered in trees. That's some of them are being mined out, so you can still see the black and red exposed cinders on that clack volcanic buttes. What a name for that. Anyways, so, in here we have a great amount of volcanoes and we have earthquake activity striking right in the middle of all of it. Just a zero, nothing indicating any eruption. This is indicating seismic activity getting ready to happen off the coast. So your dormant volcanoes start to move. And I could prove each one of these down to the south if I needed to, but I don't need to. You guys can go check my past videos or I will just name these for you. Inskip Volcanic Buttes, just southeast of Mount Shasta, northwest of Lassen. And that's the Lassen Volcanic Center. That's the blue earthquake I just marked up here in Northern California. This big stack, Clear Lake Volcano, Geysers, California. And that's a geothermal pumping operation where they're drilled into the upper reaches of the volcano itself to steam off water. And that turns turbines that then provides power. Going down here to the east-southeast, we have two different swarm locations, one on the Nevada side of the border, one on the California side of the border, and I probably should show it to you because it's much more impressive than telling you. We have Mud Springs Volcanic Butte and Aurora Crater. So right here, and let me bring this in at an angle as well. So you'll be able to see the crater here and the old obsidian and black volcanic rock still exposed and the lava flow there. And then over to the west, we have Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. Or to the east, I'm sorry. We have Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. Let me bring that due north again. So there is another cinder, and then we have our lava flows that now have trees on them. It's about 300 feet high off the desert floor, letting you know how big that lava flow was. So a new swarm there. Then a new swarm right here at Mono Lake Volcano, and I'll show that to you as well. Then going across the border down to Mammoth Lakes. Mammoth Lakes is well known. It's a ski resort, but it's also a volcano. Right here. Here's Mammoth Mountain. Okay, and Mammoth Lakes. The swarm is happening at Whitmore Hot Springs, which is a hot springs location. So your volcanoes start to swarm. That's the first sign. Second sign, your pumping operations as well as your geothermal operations start to move. And that's oil, gas, and geothermal. Well, I just talked about the geothermal operation over here at Clear Lake, and Whitmore Hot Springs is a hot springs location, which is a natural geothermal location. Then getting down here, see this swarm right here? Let's go get our coordinates. Little Lake, California. There is a little lake there, but that's not the purpose of showing you. We're not going to look at a little lake. If it's even there, it may have evaporated for all I know, depending on, you know, what the drought situation out there in California is like. But we're coming in here, and you'll probably be, your eye will be drawn to the big scorched marked, pockmarked surface indicating multiple cinder cones from Volcano Peak and Coso Volcanic Field, which right here, Coso Field, let's zoom in on this. See this place? It's called Devil's Kitchen, where they've drilled into the upper reaches of the magma chamber, pipe and water. Water steams off. Steam is collected in pipes, taken to these turbines to turn the turbines and provide power. That's what they're doing there. That's, again, I mean, look, there's multiple different signs that have to be met, and that's another sign. Pressure has come up past the volcanoes and coming up to the pumping operations where humans have drilled down into the earth. And we go back just one day and the LA Basin got hit at the pumping operations. Finally, the third sign is that your fault zones start to move in between the volcanoes and the pumping operations and the creeping section of the San Andreas, the Hayward Fault, right across San Francisco itself. Look, it's a diagonal line of earthquakes. I mean, it's pretty obvious. Take a look at it. A diagonal line of earthquakes going from Eureka, California, all the way down to, let's say, north of Santa Barbara. I mean, how long is that? That's 300 or 400 miles across. 300 or 400 miles moving all on a 2.0 basis, all in a day, with a couple swarms right in the middle. And this is all pointing towards one thing getting ready to happen, a new earthquake up here off the coast. The final warning sign, the final criteria that needs to be met, are the man-made blast zones, sometimes mines, sometimes quarries, and sometimes, most of the time, the nuclear test sites where humans have detonated underground nuclear bombs that have put huge fractures into the crust, which are now vulnerable over time due to pressure seeping in and, of course, seeking out a path of least resistance. And see this crater field here. This is a spot where the U.S. has done, along with Australia, Great Britain, and Canada, and France also, been allowed to do their underground nuclear tests in these locations. And you guys are welcome to pause it, and or if you want to go download Google Earth, you can actually then come through and click on each one of these just to read the information, but it'll give you the kiloton, the date, what it was called, what's the name of the operation. Again, it's really interesting. People have taken a lot of time. U.S. Nuke Operation Metropolis, March 10th, 1990, 150 kilotons. Wow. I thought they stopped doing underground nuke tests by then. Huh. Interesting. 1990? Maybe that's the date that they posted it. Anyways, there is a large amount of information on this, and right next to it, and I mean right next to it, where they've done other tests, so we have other test sites. I mean, tunnel, underground tunnels, gumdrop, 21, 20 kiloton detonation right there. And all I'm saying, it's, again, not a sign they're doing any kind of nuke test. When these four criteria are met, when the dormant volcanoes are swarming, when your oil, gas, and geothermal pumping operations are getting hit, when the fault zones in between those operations and those volcanoes are also moving, and the nuke test sites finally light up, it's a sign that pressure has seeped into the whole West Coast, as far east as Nevada, and if you take the fracking operations into consideration at least, that it's, again, going all the way over into the Midwest, that's inundation across half the plate. And if it's inundation across half the plate, that's a sign that there's something pushing out here off the coast. So something's currently pushing all of California, Nevada, all the way over to the Midwest. Now, guys, hold on. What's this? Where did this come from? Are you kidding me? Hold on. No way. No way. Are you kidding me? Guys. Oh my God, we issued a earthquake forecast for New Jersey this week. Oh my God, look, sonic boom, offshore New Jersey. You're kidding me. an earthquake happened there, and they're trying to call it a sonic boom? Oh my God, this is an ultra facepalm, real-time live. I can't believe it. We issued a warning, and I even named out New Jersey. I named out New Jersey specifically. Look, 99 felt reports. 99 people felt it. 100 people felt it. It wasn't a sonic boom. Magnitude question mark? Sonic boom? Are you kidding me? Oh man, we got, look where it hit too. This is epic. This is beyond epic. This is the epic fail. Now I can forecast sonic booms. I can forecast sonic booms, guys. Not just military tests, not just mine collapses, not just mistakes. We can forecast sonic booms. Boom! What up? Oh, man, I can't believe it. That's funny. Okay. All right. Well, guys, I am shocked and appalled that they have an earthquake in Nevada or in New Jersey. Oh, my God. I'm sorry. I don't know how to respond to this. Okay. Well, there's the earthquake we were looking for. It wasn't a sonic boom. We talked about why we were looking in New Jersey and why we would be looking on the East Coast. It was because of activity coming out of the Midwest. We told you the leftovers off the Midwest hit the East Coast. Now they have it at 0.0 question mark. I've never seen a question mark earthquake. I've never. In all my years. In all my years. Never in my life have I seen such a dastardly deed that was just done there. Okay, I'm just mind struck. Okay, we have to watch on the West Coast at this point. This should prove it to you. We issued a warning for New Jersey. New Jersey got hit. They tried to call it a sonic boom. They have denied every step of the way earthquakes. Now, this makes two in the past 2 days. First, a 4.8 to 5.0 struck out here in the area where we issued the warning. And they chose to hide the earthquake and not report it to try and make us look bad. That's it. Or there's an eruption happening at the location, or both. And we issued a warning now for New Jersey, and New Jersey got hit, and 99 people felt it, meaning it was a pretty big shakeup, and they're going to try and call it a sonic boom. What a bunch of douchebags. Not the people in New Jersey. I'm talking about the people at the USGS and the people trying to hide earthquake forecasting. Wow. Well, you know what? When it's all said and done, I'm putting this in my book. When it's all said and done, someday I'll have a book out and it's going to have this in it. And I'm going to talk about how the establishment science went so far as to hide earthquakes. And I'll name all their names too. And I'll say, I don't know if I can prove this. It's just my opinion that it may have been them. So I can do that and put it in writing and put their names there forever. Because this is going to be epic. Can you believe they did that? On the West Coast, magnitude-wise, I want you to look for the same-sized magnitudes that are striking around the rest of the plate right now. So how big are they going? They're going up to 5.4, 5.0, 5.1. We're going to be in the 5 range on the West Coast. But, that's the first start of this. By the end of the week, we're going to be going up most likely another step higher, probably into the 6 range. In the same location, twice, here on the West Coast, coast of Oregon, coast of Northwest California, twice this week. After these deep earthquakes, there's no way around it. Japan's going to be getting hit as well. Over here in the West Pacific, several areas are going to be getting hit. The middle of our fulcrum point, our silent zone. Now, I don't have time to go in and name each location again, but I do have to tell you, we're going to be seeing an increase at each location, and let me just describe this, where there's currently 4.0 activity. We're definitely going to be seeing 5.0 activity. I think that's a no-brainer. Where there's currently 5.0 activity, we're going to be seeing above 6.0 activity, most likely. That means Indonesia. I mean, it's pretty obvious. It also means Japan. It means going over to the west, where you see fours, there's going to be fives. Where you see fours, there's going to be fives. It's a no-brainer. This is going to increase things across the planet, everywhere that's connected to the Pacific plate. That includes Mexico, Central America, going into Northern South America. For my people in Mexico, look, this is no bueno. This is not good. First of all, you're already increasing because of the current set of deep quakes that are putting pressure across right now on our red arrows. You've already gone back up to 5.0 today, and you had threes, and it was looking good, but now you've replaced by a 4.6 and a 4.7 over the past couple days. Take a look at it. So the 4.7 is the most recent, 5.0 a day ago, and technically this is a decrease. I'm going to have to say this is a decrease, I mean, comparatively from where we were, but a decrease right now, not good. You would expect this to actually kick up a little, not go quiet, not get a couple threes and a four. After all this, all these deep earthquakes pushing up on one side of the plate, it's looking like over the next several days, Central America and South America, specifically where the arrows point, that is going to be receiving the incoming brunt off the West Pacific. There's only a few transfer zones that allow for pressure to come directly across. See our yellow arrow? Okay, get a big earthquake on the coast of Japan. Within a few days, you usually get a big earthquake off the coast of California. That's why the yellow arrow's there. We've seen it happen before, but only with big earthquakes. And I mean with the sevens and the eights. As we go over into South America, let's quickly talk about the volcanic eruptions here. Let's go over to the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Now, I don't forecast eruptions, but we have to look every day. This plays into the earthquake activity. So Ulawan is back on the list. Tinakula on the list again. Now, Papua New Guinea and Solomon Islands are right next to each other. Sabancaya in Peru. Dukono in Indonesia. Shivalush up in Russia. Tinakula again, Sinabung in Indonesia, Ulawan, Sabancaya, Dukono, Tinakula, Sabancaya, Reventador in Ecuador, Tinakula, Dukono, Sabancaya, Tinakula. Some of these are cancellations, but we get into Mexico, Popocatépetl. And guess what? I went over and checked the webcam, and it showed clear. So the webcam from the fake webcam at Webcams de Mexico is really not showing because new eruption today, it showed clear. Anyways, they're hiding the eruptions in Mexico. Isn't that funny? And then, beyond that, Sabancaya, Tinakula, Reventador. It's a pretty long list today. The list is twice as long as it was yesterday. And let's just quickly show you where all these are. We'll start right here in the middle where we're already looking at Popocatépetl here in Mexico, sending off a new blast, indicating that pressure has arrived into Mexico, but the earthquakes have stopped, or at least gone down. But that's not good. We would expect it to go up. Fuego has stopped erupting. Turrialba has stopped erupting. But we have Reventador volcano erupting right there in Ecuador, and Sabancaya volcano here erupting down in South Peru. Going all the way across the Pacific, we have right here in the middle, in the middle of all this, right here where you see there's no earthquakes, we have Tinakula volcano, and we also have, let's see, Ulawan volcano over in eastern Papua New Guinea, like right about here. So that's pretty much right across the location that there's no earthquake activity, but multiple eruptions. You can expect that to be replaced right in the middle, fulcrum point, in the next few days. No doubt about it. And same with over in South America and Central America. We have to talk about these in conjunction with one another. That's why I'm going back and forth like this. These deep earthquakes will push over to South America and Central America. So we absolutely, positively must figure out what the magnitudes are going to be on this side as they push over to South America. Let me quickly explain for my South American viewers. Pressure transfers across the Pacific, and it follows these fracture zones. Do you see these fracture zones? They go east to west. They look like rungs on a ladder. or they look like latitude on a map almost. But these are fracture zones. These fracture zones make a V shape, a sideways V shape that comes all the way back here. And when pressure is put back here on the backside, guess what? It divides and goes up to the north and down to the south, usually equally. So you'll get 5.0 pressure to the north, 5.0 pressure to the south, for instance. But at times like this, when there's multiple deep earthquakes and the whole West Pacific is being pushed up from the western side, well, it means that the eastern side, Central America and South America particularly, are going to move. Look at their fracture zones. Look where they connect through to. They connect right through to the spots that are moving now. And this is going to increase. Like I said, over in the West Pacific, everywhere where there are fours, there's going to be fives. Well, guess what's going to happen here? Everywhere there are fives, you guessed it. Everywhere there are fives, there should be upper fives to 6.0. That's right. So luckily, there's only a couple spots where there's fives, right? Let's get all the fours off there. Here's our fives and greater. So fives and greater, there's two spots. That means two sets of sixes. And then everywhere where there's fours, there's going to be fives. That's an increase across all of South America. That means we need to warn the people in Ecuador right now. Let them know 5.0 activity is coming. We need to warn the people back in central Peru, right at central Peru, north of Sabancaya. Let them know 5.0 activity is coming. Let the people know in northern Argentina and Bolivia know that 5.0 activity is coming. And let the people down the coast of Chile that multiple 5.0s are coming and that a 6 is coming to the north. Let them know. And it's going to be big. Why? Because you can't get pressure, at least a displacement, on one side of the plate and not see compensation on the other. If this all flops and nothing happens, I will be back on to discuss that, surely, because the chances of nothing happening are beyond astronomically high, or low, or however you want to refer to that. In other words, that the chance of nothing happening is very, very low. There's going to be movement off these deep earthquakes. We've seen enough examples of that in the past to show it and prove it over and over again. I need only take you back to a month and a half ago. One and a half months ago, I can't even say it, struck right here. 6.0 earthquake. Then, the next day, an 8.1 struck in Mexico. Shallow. First a deep 6, then a shallow 8. Go back to December. 3 different deep earthquakes occurred, followed by 3 shallow 7.9 earthquakes going right up to Christmas Day, right down here in Chile, and 2 over here in Solomon Islands and Papua New Guinea. All 3 7.9s, all 3 in December of this past year, just 10 months ago. So we have past examples of deep 6s causing shallow 7.9s to 8.0s. Is it going to happen again? I hope I'm wrong. But hope. Enough for hope. And if you're in the United States, you've got to watch close here out on the West Coast. Once this gets hit, guess who's going to get hit after that? Southern California and the Midwest. But I'll be on before then. I'll have another update out over the next few days. Right now, we're watching on the West Coast. Okay. Have your plans dusted off. Be prepared just in case. Go watch my video update from last night if you want any more information. But these deep earthquakes are the only real new players in the past several days that we have to be concerned about. And I'm very, very serious. When you warn people in the West Pacific, you've got to tell them, look, you're being pushed up from the underside. When that pressure comes up from the underside, there's usually an increase in power. Now, the spots that are due to be hit are the spots that haven't been hit yet. And so that reduces our areas dramatically. You can see the silent zones. You can see the spots that need to be filled in between the earthquakes. Those are the next spots to move. And how many are there? There's a bunch. 1, 2, 3, 4... 5, I mean, there's at least 5 zones here that are going to be filled in the next few days by shallower, larger movement. That's just around the deep earthquake itself. When we go out beyond that, We get over to the east. We have one giant zone. So that just means one spot right in the middle we're watching. Thank God. You get down here to New Zealand. You got another spot in between the deep earthquakes. That's the Kermadec Islands, south of Tonga. I could just go on for many more minutes here and issue a whole new weekly forecast at this point, based upon the new deep earthquakes. But we're going to ride the current forecast through until Sunday. And like I said, today is Wednesday going into Thursday. So Friday, Saturday, into Sunday, we have 2.5 to 3 more days to go. We're halfway through. And the new deep earthquake happened technically a day ago, day and a half. We have 10 days to go on this deep earthquake. This deep earthquake is going to overlap in my forecast, obviously, for this next week. Because we give it 7 to 10 days from the point of the deep earthquake like this for shallow or larger movement to surface. It can take a while. Usually it takes a few days, not the full 10 days. That's good news, right? So we don't have to wait long for that. And that's the best news I have for you. I would encourage you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared just in case to know what to do when a large earthquake strikes and a moderate earthquake. Moderate earthquake, you can shelter in place for the most part. So table, desk, you'll get underneath it. It'll stop the falling debris. It'll stop maybe a falling picture frame. It'll stop falling drywall and plaster falling from the ceiling. That would be ideal if you're in a moderate-sized earthquake, those 4 and 5.0 earthquakes. But once you get up above that 4 and 5.0 threshold, when you get to upper 5s and 6s and 7s, those are big earthquakes, very large earthquakes. And they're enough to really cause interior shaking, knock everything off the shelves, knock things over your refrigerator, break gas lines, cause infrastructure damage on bridges. That's the upper 5s, 6s, and 7s. Once you get above 7 and you get into the upper 7, 8, and 9, that's the megaquake realm, where even if you're in an earthquake secure structure, you're still going to be feeling it pretty hard. There's going to be a lot of broken things inside. And if you're in a brick structure, you got to get out. If you're in a cinder block structure in a big earthquake to megaquake, you've got to get out. So in a 5, 6, 7, or 8, or 9 earthquake, you've got to be able to get out of a brick building or a stone structure. Got to be able to have an exit plan. If you don't have an exit plan, you need a shelter-in-place plan. Both plans should incorporate something called a preparedness bag or a security kit or a bug-out bag. There's many different terms for it, but it's just a bag that you keep that has many different things in it that you might need in case of emergency. Usually, people's bug-out bags cover everything from a flood, being able to leave your house, usually has a copy of your ID, has a few survival kit items, first aid, maybe a form of communication, maybe a form of self-defense if you're living in the city or something, you're worried about other people, right? So think about these things ahead of time. I'm not here to be your guru on these kind of things, just to remind you, you need a plan. And don't be scared. Don't be scared this week. You have the heads up that something's coming. You can see it here floating by on the screen right now. The big deep earthquakes pushing up on the underside of the plate. Now you understand the reason behind, and going forward, it removes the fear and it replaces it with vigilance. It's like a firefighter going through the training so that you can be prepared when the fire is happening. Okay, so that's what we're doing. We're watching this. We're waiting for it to happen. You're not panicking. You're warning the people around you. If you know anybody in these areas, you're telling them. And you got somebody to blame if nothing goes down. You could dump it on me. That's what I'm here for. I'd rather take the beating online than have you guys take some kind of pummeling with your house falling on you. I'd rather warn you of a storm that I see and have the storm go away than not warn you and just be like, oh, I'm so worried that somebody's going to be mad at me for warning them. I don't care if you're offended that I warned you. I'm telling you what I see, like I see a storm off in the distance. If the storm looks like it's going to blow away or fall apart, I will tell you as well. So either way, I'm going to be here, and I am watching this like a hawk. I'm watching very closely all day and all night. Speaking of watching all day and all night, have you guys seen my website? You seen it? We got it all running again? Check this out. Look at this. Before class goes, you need to see what you're helping support here. We've got the website back up and running. And look, man, my viewers are responding. dutchsinse.com, 5,780 shares on my most recent post on Facebook. That's good. That's really good for anybody. And so that's really good. And then we've got the Instagram now working. And check this out. This is outside my house earlier today. Look at this. This is just a couple hours ago over our house. Now, some people seem to think these are California something or others. We call them turkey vultures, okay? That's what they look like. So they have almost like a turkey head to them. And there's nothing dead or anything. They flock every night on the updrafts on the lake that we live by. And so we're posting this kind of stuff over here on my Instagram if you want to come over and check it out. And we've got the cats on here and everything like that. So word up and much love to the Duchess for getting that going on the Instagram. And this is in, these are samples. These were sent to me by viewers, believe it or not. So that's a petrified leaf caught in an ancient piece of mud. We've got, of course, petrified coral, petrified I guess that's a starfish. I don't know, sand dollar. And of course, then we've got all kinds of other cool stuff sent by viewers from around the world. To add to my growing and now global collection. And that's all thanks to generosity from viewers. I also want to thank everybody who's taken part in my fundraiser so far. We are now at, well, guys, I think we're over 80%. I'm pretty sure we are over 80%. Let's get that on the screen here, too, really quick, and just give a shout-out to everybody. Check it out. Yeah, here we are. We're at $9,817 raised. We're 82% of the $12,000 goal for the year, and it's only been running 15 days. My viewers are very, very generous, and there are 234 people that have contributed, and you are all very much appreciated. We're trying to hit the $12,000 goal. I set it for $1,000 a month, and if we go beyond that, that's your generosity. And I'm going to leave it up for the full 30 days. But it's getting ready to end here in a little bit. We only got two more weeks to go. And again, I'm not going to push it after we hit the goal. I'll keep it up, maybe, maybe not. But I certainly won't be mentioning it every night after we hit the goal. Also, there is a Patreon link down below if you want to go check out my Patreon. Patreon is a way to compensate me on a monthly basis, like a dollar. So most people do $1 to $5, and then that adds up with hundreds of people. There's over 500 people on Patreon that are contributing on Patreon now. So big ups to all you guys and gals and everybody in between. Much love. You are the best for helping me. And to everybody who's new, word up. Thanks for listening. Will you please subscribe to my channel? I don't have any big multi-channel networks, you know, backing me on YouTube. I have to actually ask you to subscribe. So if you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Make my channel grow. Trying to get it into something that's respectable on YouTube. And you know how that goes. You got to be in the millions now to get any kind of clout on YouTube. Man, we're trying to get it there. And it will get there at some point if you guys subscribe and share the information. And we'll be back on if anything else goes down. Good morning, good afternoon.